So today we're going to talk about blood pressure. I know you've heard this word a lot, blood pressure. What is blood pressure? Where does that pressure come from? So blood pressure is the pressure in the vessels of our body. You know, we have channels in our body that circulate everything. And that's how it's like the channels in a field. It takes things to the field and it takes things away from it. So that's what our channels are. It's composed of arteries and veins and capillaries. And in order for things to go in and out of there and to go to every organ, every cell of the body, we need some pressure. And that's what blood pressure is. So how do we get that blood pressure? Was it too fast? Okay, blood pressure. So we have channels in our body. They're called the arteries, the veins, and the capillaries. And what these channels do is they take stuff to every organ, every tissue, every cell of the body. And they take away stuff that the body doesn't need away from it. And so that's the channels. And to get things moving through the channels, you need a pressure. Otherwise, it's going to be stagnant, right? Just like the channels in your plumbing at home, or channels in a field where you are providing water for plants to grow. If you have stagnant, it won't get there. And so our body has a really nice mechanism of getting everything to every cell of the body. And that is blood pressure. So how do we have a pressure? How does it happen? There are two things that creates the blood pressure: the heart and the blood vessels. So there's the heart that pumps the blood. And every time it pumps with a pressure because it's a muscle. And so it pumps and it creates a pressure. And it pumps into these channels. And the first channels it pumps into are called arteries. So the blood enters the arteries. And the arteries have muscles in them. And so they can be stiff, or they can be relaxed, or they can be anything in between. So the blood pressure of anybody is basically a combination of the pressure that the heart is giving and the pressure that's in the blood vessels. And it varies. You can change that. The human body will change the pressures as needed. So it will change the pressure in the gut. If you have just eaten, the pressure is different in the gut than it is in your body, physical body. So the pressure will change. And not only that, the pressure changes from organ to organ, the pressure changes from second to second, minute to minute. So I don't know if you've ever had a chance to go to the ICU. What we do in the intensive care unit is we actually put a little catheter in one of the arteries of the patient, and we connect it to a barometer. And we can monitor the pressure every single second. And if you look at the monitor, you can see it changing every second. Every time the pulse beats, there's a different pressure. So that's how much the body is constantly adjusting the pressure. So that's what blood pressure is. So why do we need a blood pressure? Well, you know, you've eaten something, you're breathing in oxygen, you're taking in water, you're taking all these nutrients, but they're all going into the gut, the lungs for the oxygen, but the brain is sitting over here. The toes are sitting down there. The brain doesn't walk down and say, excuse me, lungs, can I have a little oxygen? Or go down to the gut and say, what did you just eat today? I need some magnesium and I need some nutrients so I can do my work. Mm-mm. The brain sits up there. And so the blood, with the pressure that is given by the heart and the blood vessels, goes to the brain. And the brain is bathed by all of this blood that has come thanks to the pressure. And so then it can use what it needs to do so that you can do what you're doing like right now, listening to me. If you had no pressure in your brains, you would not have your eyes open right now. I know each one of those pressures is perfect right now. And so then the brain does its work, but guess what it does? It makes some trash on the side. What does it do with the trash? We throw it in a trash can. Well, the brain doesn't have a trash can. So it trashes it back into the blood. And so all that blood then has to be pumped down into my favorite organ, the kidneys. And then the kidneys get rid of the trash. So for that reason, we need a blood pressure. So then what is high blood pressure? You know, you hear about high blood pressure and low blood pressure. And what's normal blood pressure? And I'm going to tell you this that you may not have heard before, but there is no normal blood pressure. So when somebody says, oh, I have normal blood pressure, I ask them, really? What is it? Because there is no normal blood pressure. The normal blood pressure for you or for you or for you is will be different. And the normal blood pressure after you've gone for a run or you woke up in the morning is going to be different. The blood pressure after you've done morning meditation or after a day's work is going to be different. So there is no normal blood pressure. So in every individual, in every situation, for every age, the blood pressure is different. So if anybody ever tells you, I have normal blood pressure, we don't know what they're talking about. But we can look at a person, we can, in that situation, we can say, this is normal for you. Prior to this session, you may have noticed that a few people did come and got their blood pressure checked. And I said, this is normal. What did I mean? I meant that in that situation, for that person, it was okay. Yeah? So that is what normal blood pressure is. There is nothing like that. So then what is high blood pressure? Anything that's higher than what it should be. And what is low blood pressure? Anything that it shouldn't be. Too low is not good either. High blood pressure is bad for the body. Why? Why is high blood pressure bad? You know, with every pulse, generally the pulse beats 60, 70, 80 times a minute, right? So with every pulse, there's a pressure that's created. The pressure that the heart, when the beat happens is called the systolic blood pressure or the upper number that you see. And then when the heart relaxes, there is a pressure that you see, and that's the diastolic blood pressure. So there is a systolic and a diastolic blood pressure, upper number and a lower number. So in an average, say 70 times a minute, 70 blood pressures are being created for the body. Now imagine if they were high. It's like beating up the body or the organs 70 times a minute. If I beat this boy up one time, he's going to be out of here. He's going to think this lady is crazy. She's beating me up. She doesn't know what she's doing here. But guess what we are doing with that high blood pressure? We are beating ourselves, every organ of the body, from the brain down to the toes, 70, 80 times a minute. And those poor organs, they have no way to run away. They can't do what this boy can do. Stuck inside this body, getting beaten up 70 times, 80 times a minute. So now you can imagine why high blood pressure is bad, right? What about low blood pressure? What happens when you have low blood pressure? Well, the organs need perfusion. I just told you how you can get your nutrients. The brain's not going to run down to the gut to get their food or go down to the lungs to get their oxygen. Somebody's got to get it up there. And the blood pressure gets it up there. Think about it. The brain is sitting here. The heart is here. The gut is down there. Against the gravity, there is blood going to the brain. How is it doing it? It's doing it because of the blood pressure. So that is what blood pressure is all about, and about what high and low blood pressure all means. So between high and low, you know, what should be run? What's really good for us? You know, there is a little bit of a range that I can kind of give you today. And the range is that I'm not going to talk about under 18. I'm sorry, because I'm an adult doctor, so I'll keep the information under 18 out. But for above 18 years of age, the younger people should run lower blood pressures. So for them, say 18 to 30, the lower the better. Even a top number of 90 or low 100 or 110 is probably ideal for them. But as you age, the blood pressures do rise. And so by the time the person ages to the age of 60 or 70 or 80 years of age, if the doctor lowers their blood pressures down to 100 or 110, they can handle that. They start getting lightheaded and dizzy and falls and all kinds of kidney problems. And so for that reason, as you age, the blood pressure should go up. But even the oldest of the oldest should not run blood pressures over 150. Once in a while, you know, you are under some stress or whatever, and you have a little bit high blood pressure is not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about consistently running high blood pressures. And so there is a ballpark idea that we give everybody about their blood pressure, and that's what I'm giving you today. Yeah, I'm talking about the systolic blood pressure. I apologize for not making that clear. The diastolic blood pressure should always run under 80 in everybody. A diastolic blood pressure over 80, whether you are 15 years old or if you are 100 years old, if it's over 80, is high blood pressure. And a lot of people don't realize that. They think 85 is okay and 90 is okay. A diastolic number of 90 is actually severe blood pressure, severe hypertension. Yeah, so the question is, I'll repeat the question. The question is, what happens to your blood pressure when you exercise? We usually don't check blood pressures when you're actually dancing or running. Typically, we don't. And the blood pressure does go up. If you put a cuff on somebody and you make them run on a treadmill, their blood pressures will go up. But almost immediately after that, the pressures start to come down.
Thing like, because you're hitting your body cannot go away from that, and that hitting is happening. So I'm asking, like, doing an exercise is a good thing because you want to be fit. And of course, when you do that, like, blood pressures automatically increase because you cannot stop it.
Correct.
In that case, it is okay. I'm saying
it is okay as long as it's still low. So say you're suppose you're exercising and you're getting your blood pressures higher than what it should be for you, that's not good enough.
Okay.
So then you do need to correct your blood pressure so that no matter what you do, your blood pressures stay within the range that is right for you.
Okay.
So if you are, you know, suppose your normal is 120, top number, a lower number less than 80, then you start to run and your blood pressure goes up to 160, that's not good for you. That means you need something done as to why your blood pressure is running up when you are running. Is there a stiffness of the blood vessels or what's going on? Yeah. All right. So we go to the next thing, and that is, what are the different types of blood pressures? So you may have heard about blood pressure, but I don't know if you've ever heard about the types of blood pressures. And there are actually two types of blood pressures, and everyone should be aware of that. And the one is what everybody knows, and that's called essential hypertension. That's what we call it in medical words, essential hypertension or high blood pressure. It's also basically says idiopathic, which means the doctors don't know. It's like, we don't know why you have high blood pressure. And so that is called essential hypertension or idiopathic hypertension. And majority of the people have that kind of blood pressure. It's the doctors don't know why you have high blood pressure. And that usually happens between the ages of about 35 to 60, 65. So if the blood pressure you start developing high blood pressure between that age, majority of the times it means that you have essential hypertension. Of course, we do have to take a history, and the history, we'd ask the patients, you know, you have a family history, or look for other reasons as to why they would have high blood pressure. But in general, between 35 to 60, we don't do a lot of testing to look out for secondary causes of hypertension or high blood pressure. So there is a second form of high blood pressure. We call it secondary hypertension or secondary form of high blood pressure. And that is from something happening to the body that is causing the blood pressure to go up. And so you can treat that and fix the blood pressure. And so that is very important to look for. And a lot of times it's getting missed these days, because everybody's in such a hurry to just, you know, get their blood pressure fixed and move on, that secondary hypertension is being missed a lot these days. So some of the common causes of secondary hypertension are other diseases. So kidney disease can cause hypertension. And if somebody with kidney disease just goes and sees their doctor and they say a high blood pressure and they start giving them medicine, they missed a kidney disease. And the only way to find it is a little blood sample, a little blood draw. Similarly, diabetes causes high blood pressure. So you go in and your blood pressure is high. No one checked your blood sugar to see, is there a problem from the diabetes? Is the cause of the hypertension? These are common things. These are happening a lot. And then there are rarer things, like we have an endocrine system in our body that produces different kinds of hormones. And an up and down of those hormones can raise and lower blood pressures. It's often missed by physicians because it's not that common, but it is quite often missed. Another common cause is pregnancy, actually. There is pregnancy-related hypertension, which goes away after the child is born. It's very common. So there are a lot of reasons for medicines can cause high blood pressure, by the way. There are certain medicines that will raise blood pressures. So anytime there is blood pressure, it's always a good idea to make sure it's not your decision. It's the physician that looks for, do I need to look for secondary hypertension or should we just treat this as essential? And so that is something to look into. The next thing I wanted to talk to you about is, you know, how do you check your blood pressure? There's a lot of machines that are out there. You know, there are machines that you can put on your wrist. There are machines you can put on your fingers. There are machines that go on the cuff, on the arm, excuse me. You can actually get leg blood pressure machines. You can do blood pressures on your lower part of the leg as well. So which is a good blood pressure machine? You know, in our doctor's offices, we always used the stethoscope. And when I started checking blood pressures, I never had this automated machine in my office, because I thought, this is not right. The patients come to the office, we should check it with a stethoscope. Until 3 years ago, there was an article in the Journal of Internal Medicine, American Journal of Internal Medicine, that said doctors' blood pressures are erroneous. It was an editorial article that All blood pressures and doctor's offices are erroneous. So there was a hue and cry in all the doctor's offices. We said, all right, we're just going to stop checking blood pressures. The real problem was that when you go to a patient with a stethoscope and you start checking their blood pressure, they get anxious, they get nervous. It raises their blood pressure. And so the forced blood pressure is always high. And Nima is laughing because that's exactly what happened to her. Even though we used an automated machine, 5 minutes later, her blood pressure was normal. So that will happen because of just anxiety. So now the recent accepted norm is to get machines like these in doctor's offices, where we put the patient in a room and we put the machine on and we leave them there. And you can change this machine where it'll check blood pressures 5 minutes apart and it'll record all those three readings. We leave the patients alone in the room. So allow them to relax, allow them to meditate or whatever else they want to do. And then we check a blood pressure and we usually take the last reading as the correct reading. And it always lowers most of the time, 99% of the times it does. So at home, the machines that you all have are all good, but you got to prove that they are good. So I always tell patients to check their blood pressures at home with two machines. You don't have to buy two machines. All you have to do is to take your machine and check it against another machine. It could be your friend's machine. It could be a machine in one of the pharmacies. Or you are welcome to take your blood pressure machine to your doctor's office. I really encourage that. They bring your machine with you. Because if it's going to be high with my machine, it's going to be high with their machine also. And so we know, okay, they bring a record of their blood pressures looking perfect. And I'm getting a high blood pressure in my office. I ignore my blood pressure. I go by what they are bringing me in. Because that is the correct blood pressure. They're just nervous being in. And what is that blood pressure called when you get nervous in the doctor's office? Yeah, who said that? Oh my goodness, you're so smart. Okay. So it's called white coat hypertension. And even though white coat is becoming kind of obsolete nowadays, a lot of the physicians don't wear it, but it's still a white coat hypertension is what we call it. And it gets better if you can just leave the patients alone. But some will have white coat hypertension no matter what. So as a physician who relies a lot on high blood pressure, I do not really put a lot of emphasis on the pressures I get at my office. I encourage people to check blood pressures at home. When they are relaxed, when they're in their home environment, that is where they're going to spend most of their time. Check your blood pressure there. And every machine is accurate, but you got to prove it that by checking it against another machine. Very important. Being a brand new machine or whether it's a $100 machine or a $10 machine, it doesn't matter. I just had somebody pick up 100 blood pressure machines in a church sale for $2. And I thought they'd be all useless, but I have checked 10 of those machines and just changed the batteries on them, perfect blood pressure machines. So it doesn't matter where you get the machine from or how old it is. In fact, sometimes old is gold. So that's about the machines. You can use the machine that goes on the wrist or the ones on the fingers. It doesn't matter. It just needs to be checked against another machine so that it's accurate. All right? So then when do you check your blood pressure? Is it good to check it in the morning or do you want to check it in the afternoon when you wake up after your evening nap, after a cup of tea? When is the best time to check your blood pressure? Well, the best time to check your blood pressure, if you are on no medications at all, is when you have time. Because you're on no blood medications, your blood pressure should be good anytime. So you can check it in the morning if you are a morning kind of person. But if you have no time in the morning, anytime. Even anybody with normal blood pressure, what they think is normal, should get their blood pressures checked 2 times in a year. high blood pressure or low blood pressure or an abnormal blood pressure is a very good indicator of what's going on in the body. So twice a year, make a sincere effort to check your blood pressure, either in your doctor's office or you can check it in any machine. If the machines sometimes in the CVS, Walgreens, they can be erroneous. And if you see an erroneous reading, always go back to the pharmacist and tell them that we got a high reading coming. And they'll check it for you. They have machines back in their pharmacy area that they'll bring out, and they'll check the machine for you. So twice a year, you should check your blood pressures if your blood pressures are otherwise healthy. But if you are on medications, then the best time to check your blood pressures is before you take your medications. Because you're taking medications to bring your blood pressures under normal control. So if you take your blood pressure medicine, like how it happens in my office, okay? They take their medicines in the morning at 8 o'clock with breakfast, and they come at 9 o'clock to the office, and I see a very nice blood pressure. And I go, oh, your blood pressures are great. Are they? I don't know. They just took their medicine an hour ago. I wonder what it was at 7 a.m. when they woke up. And it is not important for your blood pressures to be good for that hour or 2 hours after you took your medicine. We want the blood pressures to be good all day and all night long. 24-hour blood pressure control. And that is why most of the medicines nowadays are once-a-day medicines or twice-a-day medicines. Because you take them once, and it controls the blood pressure all day long and all night long. So always check your blood pressures before you take your medicines. Now, there are medicines that are prescribed sometimes to patients that lowers blood pressures quickly. The commonest of those are called water pills. You may be familiar with furosemide or Lasix or hydrochlorothiazide. What these do is to pull salt out of the water and make you go to the bathroom more. And they bring the blood pressures down quickly, and they don't last all day and all night. They only last a few hours. So in those situations, I will often ask them to check their blood pressures 2 hours after taking that medicine, because it can bring it down so much that it is dangerously low for them. And so if you're on a water pill, then it is a good idea to check your blood pressures, not every day, but every so often, 2 hours afterwards. But in general, checking your blood pressures before you take your medicines is the best time to check your blood pressures. Now, you check your blood pressure and it's high, higher than what it should be for you. What do you do? Good question. Then check it, what happens after you take your medicines, so that you can take that information and go to your doctor and say, I checked my medicine, my blood pressure before my medicine, and this is what it was. And just for fun, I checked it 4 hours later, and this is what it was. We have a diagnosis right there that this medicine is not doing what it's supposed to do and last the way it's supposed to. So the doctor has a responsibility then to change that. But otherwise, your blood pressure should be the same whether you have taken your medicine or not, before or after. Now, if you don't take your medicines, and unfortunately I see a lot of that, then your blood pressures are going to be high. But most of the blood pressure medicines that are being currently marketed actually have a life longer than 24 hours, so that if you forget and you take it an hour or two later, you're still protected by the medicine you had taken the day before. So remember to check your blood pressures before you take your medicines. And so that's another reason why the doctor's blood pressures are not good, because people majority of the time take their blood pressure medicines in the morning. So then the question is, when is the best time to take my blood pressure medicines? The best time to take your blood pressure medicines is in the evening. Now, there's some recent controversy on that as well. So all of you, if you're taking it in the morning or whoever is on medicines, don't change your medicines just because you heard me, okay? Talk to your doctor and see if it is really necessary. Because just a week ago, there was a study it was actually a multiple study that may not be that much of a difference. But I've been doing it for some years. I still think that nighttime blood pressure is the way to do. And I'll tell you why. You take your blood pressure and then you take your medicine. And even though the medicine has been taken every day, and so there is a steady state that you have created, there still is a little bit of a dip that happens right when you take the medicine. It typically happens in the first 1 to 2 hours of taking it after absorption. And so after you take your medicine, there is a dip. In normal people that are on no blood pressure medicines, there is something called a nocturnal dip. So when you go to sleep at night, your blood pressure dips. And it dips in the first couple of hours. So in us, as we go to bed at 10 o'clock, our blood pressure will dip slowly. And the nadir happens right between 12 and 1. And then the body starts to prepare to wake up. Majority of you wake up between 2:30 and 3, so the pressure is getting ready to wake up. This is a normal circadian rhythm of the body. In normal people, that's what's happening. There is a nocturnal dip. When somebody is going to have high blood pressure, they don't have high blood pressure right now. They check it, it's okay. But they are going to start to have blood pressure in the next few months. The first thing that goes is the nocturnal dip, which is never picked up because we never check blood pressures when they're asleep. But the studies have shown that the first thing that goes is the nocturnal dip. And if we can reintroduce the nocturnal dip, we can prevent strokes and heart attacks. So strokes and heart attacks happen most often in the morning, between 4 and 6 in the morning, as the body is waking up. And so it usually happens because of the loss of that nocturnal dip. So the pressure just runs high, high, high all through the night. And so that is why proponents like old-timers like me prefer to tell patients to take their once-a-day medicines at night before they go to bed. There are exceptions to this. And the biggest exception is a water pill. Because if I tell you that you can take your water pill and then go to bed, and then you're getting up every hour, and before you know it, it's time to wake up and meditate, you will not be happy with me. So please, if you're on a water pill, you do take that in the morning. But, or if you, there are many, many medicines that come in a combination. And you know why? I'll tell you that in a minute. But if you are on any water pill, whether it is a combination water pill, with a combination with a different blood pressure medicine plus water pill, or a plain water pill by itself, please don't take that at night, or else you won't have a good night's sleep. But otherwise, majority of the blood pressure medicines that are once a day should be taken at night. All right, so that's about when to take your blood pressure and what and how to check your blood pressures. So the next thing that I was going to talk to you about real quick is the treatment of blood pressure. And so there are medicines. There are lots of medicines out there for treatment of blood pressure. And so that's the pharmacological treatment of blood pressures. And there is non-pharmacological treatments of blood pressures. I personally do look a little bit for secondary hypertension, which is the blood pressure that happens from other causes. But if you are quite confident that you have what is called essential blood pressure, then you can just go on some treatment for it. And there are a whole host of medicines that are used. The commonest medicines actually that are used are water pills. And the reason for that is because people eat a lot of salt. And salt raises blood pressure. And so a water pill is a very easy way of getting the salt out of the body and then getting the blood pressures under control. And so one of the commonest and the first blood pressure medicine that most doctors will use is actually a water pill. And other blood pressure medicines that are out there, they won't work on a high salt diet. So if somebody is eating a lot of salt and you give them a blood pressure medicine that doesn't bring their salt down, you give the medicine won't work. They'll come back to you and they say, the medicine didn't work, doc. My blood pressures are still running high. And you ask them, are you eating salt? And they go, oh, not at all. I have not added any salt to the diet. I said, okay. What did you eat on that football game you watched on Saturday? Doritos and Fritos. Yeah. But he didn't add any salt to it. Right? So that's what happens. So they will tell you they didn't eat salt, but they are getting a lot of salt in their diet. Or those in, you know, those, you can get these pre-packed, what do you call those? The spices, pre-packed spices. Like you'll get Italian spices. It's got everything in it. And the first ingredient is salt. And so you have to educate yourself and everybody that salt is not good for you. And if you eat, add absolutely no salt to your diet, we're blessed. We eat a lot of Indian food, a majority of us do. You don't need salt. I mean, you can add all the other spices. If you had plenty of ginger and turmeric and spices and garam masala, who needs salt? You really don't. I feel sorry for those who use only salt and pepper for their cooking, because if you take their salt away, then half of their spices are gone. I get it, but honestly, salt should not be added, because the natural ingredient of everything, whether it's a vegetable or it's milk or it's anything that we eat, has salt in it. And there's plenty of salt for the body. So pharmacy is basically water pills. And in addition, you can have all kinds of other medications that are out there. And I'm not going to go into the details of that. Obviously, you are getting, you know, you have to talk to your own doctors on that. But I would like to talk for a moment about the non-pharmacological treatment of hypertension or high blood pressure. And the non-pharmacological treatment includes, actually, this is scientific. I'm not making this up. There are three or four things that have been found to decrease blood pressures. The first is diet. And I've already touched upon that with the salt. So if you restrict your salt in your diet or decrease salt in the diet, significant improvement in blood pressures. I will bring patients to the hospital because we can control their blood pressure. And I'll put them on exactly what medicines they have come in on. Their home medications is what is prescribed in the hospital. The only difference is the diet. They're on a low sodium diet. And I don't put them on a no-salt diet. I put them on a 4-gram sodium-restricted diet because that's what's palatable to me. If I can eat it, they can eat it the way I go. So the typical salt restriction is 4 grams or 4,000 milligrams, which sounds like a lot, but an average American eats between 20 to 25 grams of salt a day. So 4 grams is very restricted for them. Even an average us, we eat about 10 to 15 grams a day. It depends on what food we eat. Yes. Excellent question. Salt is sodium chloride. It has 2 sodium to 2 chloride, irrespective of what salt you use. So there is nothing like low salt, salt. There is something called salt substitutes, and those are good. There are 2 kinds. There is a salt substitute that is potassium salts. So potassium salt is one potassium to one chloride. That is the chemical. And it's less salty because of that, but it doesn't raise blood pressures. It actually lowers blood pressures. So we actually will tell patients to increase potassium in their diet to lower their blood pressures. So that's an excellent salt to take if you don't have other things going on, like kidney problems. Because in kidney disease, we have to restrict salt, potassium as well. Or diabetes has certain diabetics cannot eat potassium. So you before you take any of this information about salt versus potassium, please check it with your physicians. And the second thing is herbal salt substitutes. So there are certain herbs that taste like salt. And those are excellent because they don't have any chemical in them. And they give it flavor to the food. So I would highly recommend it that if you are on a salt restriction, to consider the herbal salt substitutes because they can't harm the body. All right, so the first thing is diet, and I talked about the salt restriction, but the other thing is weight control. Very, very important. So when you're overweight, blood pressures go up. So exercise doesn't mean that you gotta go run a marathon. Exercise means that you walk for a little bit. Maybe not even walk, maybe just get up and sit for a few times, sit up and stand. People watch a lot of television these days, so I tell them at every commercial, you gotta walk to the television and back, or walk to the bathroom and back. It's amazing how much that'll add up to. So we start there and then we increase it to as much as you can. Of course, the American Heart Association says 20 minutes, 3 days, three times a week. Well, they changed that to 5 days a week now. They just did that in April of this year. But I don't think that's adequate either. There's a lot of problem with overweight and obesity in this country. And it's primarily because what we take in is not equal to what we put out. So either we take in less or we put out more. Figure that out. And now there are lots of new medicines that have come out for weight loss. And so for those who are like really struggling, they're really struggling, it's not a bad idea for them to try that. And that's not long term. You just take it for 2 or 3 months, get the weight under control, and then you're good to go. You don't need to take those medicines forever and forever. So diet and exercise. And the third thing that is really important is meditation and decreasing your stress. You know, I can't stress that enough. I know I'm using that word as a pun. But calming yourself down, just like white coat hypertension, brings the blood pressures down. And just today we heard about how important the mind is. The mind is the most powerful tool in our body, the most powerful tool in the world. We can just use that tool to control our body. So I really think that if we can control this thought, the best medicine out there, and give ourselves the right kind of thought, it can create miracles in the body. Time and time again, since I have started this journey of mine in spirituality, I have been taught that your first thought is very important. And what most people wake up in the morning, they say, oh, I don't know what my blood pressure is going to be. Oh, I got to take all these pills. I can understand why they can't cut down my pills. Why can't they do this? Why do I have to? They're fighting their medicines. They're fighting their blood pressure. I ask them to do one thing. Send a message to the body. Thank you. Thank you for giving me one more day to be a better person, to do a better job in this world, to bring a smile on one more person. Thank you, body, for being there for me. And the second thought, if you have high blood pressure, my blood pressure is perfectly normal. Give that message to the body, and the body goes, yes, sir. But you gotta do it. with absolute affirmation. No thinking, oh, I'm just saying this, but of course I've got high blood pressure, you know. You can't do that. When you say it with meaning, that my body is completely healthy, you can cure cancer, you can cure heart disease, and this is a doctor talking. What's blood pressure? It's nothing. So I really think that there is a role of meditation and there's a role of spirituality where science is just not even close. So with that, I'm going to request Sister Ranjan to take us through a short meditation on how to meditate for this body to do what we want to do. And I'll be happy to take questions. I can do it now before the meditation or after. That's depends on before. All right, can I take questions? Again, the foods that would lower blood pressure would be those that would have lower salt content, for one thing. And the second would be that would, fat content. You have to lower that. The commonest foods that we eat that are high in salt are nuts. We get a lot of salt through nuts. And the other thing that we get a lot of salt is baked foods. We add a lot of sodium to our baking. So when you're cooking, just kind of watch out to how you cook and cut out the salt as much as possible. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Quick question. Question is about when you talk about high blood pressure, you talk about a range from, I don't remember lower range, but I'm looking at my age. So you talk about 60, 65 and above. So after that, does it mean after 65, high blood pressure does not increase?
Blood pressure should not increase after 60, after you become an adult, like 40s and 50-year-olds and 60-year-olds and 70-year-olds, you can have the same blood pressure. But if they do run it a little bit higher, it's okay up to a point. But you don't want high blood, you don't want the blood pressures running high just because you're older. It's not okay for a 60-year-old to run 160 blood pressure. It is not okay. They need to bring it down. Ideal blood pressures for a 70, 80-year-old, 90-year-old is also 140 or 130 over 80 or less.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
About asking one thing that Nima Ben asked, like this salt thing which is going on in the market, like so many variety of salt, as you said, doesn't make sense. Hello. Yeah, I'm asking like the same thing which Nima Ben asked, like about the salt. So really it doesn't matter, because what we miss from my side, like we started changing to pink salt, saying, oh, this is great, but really it is, there's no difference, or there is a difference, but not related to blood pressure. But of course, yes, like it is some benefit compared to iodized salt or something like that.
I have to give you the reality. The only difference is the flavoring. Pink salt has a different flavor than the white salt and the kosher salt, but otherwise salt is salt.
Right, so we don't eat meat, we don't get iodine, so you do need some iodized salt.
But it doesn't change the blood pressure. The iodine doesn't affect the blood pressure.
Correct.
Yeah, the salted nuts are just really salty, but just, you can also like, I don't know if you've ever seen these salted, roasted, shelled peanuts. Have you ever tasted those? They are just loaded with salt. So they could be not, you think, oh, I didn't really, salt never went in there, but it somehow does. I don't know how, but it does, right? Yeah.
Even sun-dried tomatoes.
Right.
Sun-dried tomatoes also have quite a bit of salt.
Yes, yeah.
So I have two quick questions. One is lisinopril like one of the blood pressure controlling medicines? I feel like it's pretty commonly prescribed to diabetic patients.
Which one?
Lisinopril.
Lisinopril, yeah. Uh-huh.
So you want to, it's not the type like furosemide, right? So
yes.
What does it treat then? Like, I'm curious about that.
What does lisinopril treat?
Yeah.
So lisinopril is a it belongs to a group of a family of blood pressure medicines called RAS blockade. I won't go into the detail what that basically means, but about 20 years ago, they found that if you can put diabetics on RAS blockade, you can actually slow down the kidney disease in diabetics. We were seeing a lot of diabetic kidney disease. And so lisinopril was the drug that was treated. And so because it became very popular, because there's so many diabetics and okay, lisinopril is going to take away their diabetic kidney disease or something or slow it down, it became a very popular medicine. And it's very well tolerated.
So it's a good thing to take that medication for
diabetes. It's recommended to take it, but there's not a lot more that's out there now. But this recommendation was, I think, in 95. It's a long time ago.
Because as soon as they diagnose diabetic, they're like, you
start put you on a yes, they put you on a RAS blockade.
Another question was the time to take the pill. Because I was thinking, say, in the morning also, the body's getting ready for the whole day, where we use our maximum energy and everything. Wouldn't that be a good idea to take the medicine in the morning where our blood pressure doesn't pass as the normal, like doesn't go as high, because that's where we run the risk of running it high?
Okay. Well, if you've taken a blood pressure medicine, it's supposed to like last 24 hours.
Okay.
So if you've taken your blood pressure in the evening, it should still last in the morning. Now, I'm going to ask you a counter question. And the question I'm going to ask you, I told you, if you were listening, that if when you take the blood pressure medicine, it causes a little dip, remember? Mm-hmm. Would you like to have that dip in the morning when you really got a work to do and you really need the energy, or you want to have the dip when you're sleeping at night? Which one, which is dip would you rather have?
Night one.
When you go at night, yeah. A lot of times when people take their blood pressure medicines in the morning, they'll come and complain that, doc, I take my medicines and I can't stay awake at my work. I feel sleepy. I have to drink coffee. And that's counterproductive because the coffee itself, you overdo it. You're going to raise blood pressures. I didn't even get into that today.
So maybe taking the lisinopril is also a good idea in the evening in that case.
Absolutely. Lisinopril is more than 18 hours half-life. It lasts 2 or 3 days.
My blood pressure is okay. I just said, you said just okay means not okay, okay? It's not okay. But whenever I go to doctor, it is always normal and she's very happy. You are okay, you are healthy. But I'm not really healthy, I know that. So you know what happens, maybe due to the blood pressure or what? You said it is connected, the vessels are connected to whatever it is, it comes due to that, it happens blood pressure. I feel like my veins are breaking on my thighs, both the thighs, and right thighs are more of that. I walk and stand for a while. I feel it is breaking, then I fold it and I do my exercises and all that. But due to that, may I have, it may happen blood pressure on me or what? I'm just having a pressure.
I'm actually not quite understanding. Your veins are breaking?
Veins are breaking. Yeah, vessels, I feel like that it's numbness I'm getting on my thighs.
Okay.
So maybe...
I'll take this question outside of the general, because I'll need to ask you a few more questions before I understand you well.
So there's another medication, since we went into that, losartan.
Yes.
That's not a water pill either. That's just strictly, how is that medication according to you for high
it belongs to the same class as the RAS blockade. And so it's also a long acting medicine and can be taken once a day at night.
So there's a question on Zoom. No? So anyone on Zoom, do you have a question?
Yes. Thank you so much, sister, for your information. Very beneficial. However, what is your opinion on natural remedies like hawthorn or grape extract? How do you feel about those?
I have to tell you that I'm not trained for the natural medications out there or Ayurvedic medicines for blood pressure. I'm sure they have a role. There are a lot of people taking it right now. My suggestion always is get the blood pressures under control with the medicines that are known and that are proven to control blood pressures. And then try all of these other techniques, including meditation, including Ayurveda, or including all other not so well-tested other ways of controlling blood pressure. And then as the pressure starts to get better, you know, you're going to check your blood pressures. You know, your doctor will be the first one to say, all right, I don't think you need so much. Why you don't need so much? Oh, maybe because you started meditating, or maybe because you're taking something else that is working better. So the answer is, I think they have a role, but I would not use them. Somebody's got a 160 over 90 blood pressure. That's high anybody. I would say, okay, stop taking a medicine and then also get your diet, exercise, and everything else that you have suggested.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I have one question. With any name of the test for kidney disease, would you recommend to rule out if there is a kidney disease to cause? Yeah.
May I get that question again? Did you say what is the test for kidney disease?
Yeah. To rule out the kidney disease, which may cause the high blood pressure or something. Yeah.
Actually, when you do something called root test, you know, when you go to the doctor, they say, oh, we're going to do some routine blood work before routine. It always includes the kidney function. So you can just go for routine blood work. It'll include kidney function.
Thank you.
I was saying, like the glandular function test, that's a more specialized kidney test, right? That is needed only when you're already diagnosed with disease, right? It's not because you're talking about BUN and creatinine, I'm getting from
yes.
The blood work. But I guess what they're probably getting to is insurance purposes, you know, if the doctor to know the name of the test, that this is a kidney test that I really need to kind of know, say after BUN is increased or creatinine is increased, what's the next best test to know?
Yeah, I think if there's elevation in those initial tests that are related to the kidney function, there is really no specific next test that I can really suggest besides you have to put the whole picture together and see why that elevation is happening and then figure out what test should be done because it could be so many things. Yeah.
Hi, ma'am. I have a question.
Yeah.
So what is the best time to take the medication, ma'am? Is it the evening or is it in the morning?
Yeah, that's what we were talking about, that if it's a water pill, then it's best to take it in the morning. Because you don't want to be waking up all night long going to the bathroom. So if it's a water pill that pulls out salt and water, then it's best taken in the morning. But if it's otherwise a once-a-day medication, it's generally said to take it in the evening. Now, let me add to that a lot of times people have a very hard time remembering to take their medicines in the evening. They're used to taking it in the morning, getting it over with. And so if there is an option between not taking your medicine and taking it, please take it in the morning. Because if you don't take it, that's really bad. So if you cannot remember, then it's best whatever time you remember. If the best time to remember is 2 p.m, take it at 2 p.m. So the most important thing about taking the medicine is to take it regularly. And the next best thing then is to take it in the evening if it is not a water pill, and in the morning if it is.
So what is the water pill means, ma'am? I don't know. What is the water pill means?
Water pill are diuretics, like Lasix, something that makes you go to the bathroom a lot to go and urinate a lot. You know, that's the commonest blood pressure medicines that people are put on when they've, or they're usually in combination. If sometimes you look at your water, your medicine, it has two names to it. And the second name is usually a water pill. We call it a water pill because you make a lot of water with it. That's why we call it water pill. Maybe you heard it for the first
time. Yeah, this is the first time I heard that one, ma'am.
I'm sorry.
No problem. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Thank you very much for coming and being so patient with me. Om Shanti.